Good evening. I'm State Representative Christina Sappi here in Chester County. Thank you for joining us. I am with my good friend and colleague, Representative Danielle Fiolatin, for the third in our series of panel discussions on youth mental health during the pandemic. This is something that both Rep. Otten and I have heard a lot from our constituents about, and we've broken it down into our young friends, our preschool age, elementary school age. Tonight we're going to be talking about high school age and the unique challenges our adolescent folks are experiencing during this pandemic. You know, as we know, mental health has become an increasingly big problem for our young people, and that was happening before the pandemic. So the pandemic has definitely added a new layer of complexity to this issue. And so we will be, you know, sort of peeling that apart to this evening and talking. Please feel free to send your questions in. We've received a lot of questions earlier this week by email, but please feel free to send those in to repsappy@pahouse.net. That's rep, S-A-P-P-E-Y, at pahouse.net. And I'm going to turn it over to Danielle to introduce herself right now.
Thank you, Chris. And thank you, everyone, for being here. This is our third installment of a series that we're doing on youth mental health. And, you know, as Chris said, this is an issue that we've been talking about here in our communities since well before the pandemic. Our world is changing. Our kids are up against different pressures, much different than what it was like to grow up in our time, without social media and cell phones to amplify every little adolescent struggle and challenge. And so we are excited to be here to talk to some experts about how to help our kids navigate a new world and a new horizon ahead of them and come out healthy and happy and positive and strong. So thanks so much. Excited to get into the content. I'll send it back to you, Chris.
Sure. And you can also send questions to repotten@pahouse.net. If you already have that, you can send your questions to either one of us. We'll be fielding them from both offices this evening. So I'm going to get to our panel. I'm going to introduce them one by one, and they'll give us a little bit of background on what they do and their work in this area. So first, I'd like to introduce Dr. Leah Ryder, who's the Director of Pupil Services at Unionville Chads Ford School District. Welcome, Dr. Ryder.
Thank you so much, Representative Sappi and Representative Otten. Very excited to be here to talk about this important topic. As Representative Sappi said, my name is Leah Ryder. I am the Director of Pupil Services for the Unionville Chads Ford School District. I've worked in the district for, I think, the past 14 years, I decided today. So it's been a good long ride. In my years in the district, I've worked as a special education teacher, a supervisor of special education, a director of special education, and currently I serve as the director of pupil services. And in the role as director of pupil services, I support students and our staff and our community in a variety of ways. And one of those ways that we've seen increase in the past few years has certainly been our students with mental health needs and challenges. And so obviously, as the pandemic rolled out in the past 15 or so months, we've seen those increase and we've had to address them in a variety of ways. We have a broad range of behavioral health specialists or behavioral health team members that are working hard to support our students and our staff. We have social workers, psychologists, counselors, nurses, all sorts of folks on our team. And I'm very excited to lead them. And I actually had the great opportunity to convince one of them to join me here tonight. So very excited to be part of the conversation, to learn from those on the panel, and to hopefully help support our community as we continue to address the challenges our students and their families are facing as we go through the pandemic and hopefully come out the other side. We know there will still be challenges, and we're here to just offer some resources and support. So again, thank you to the representatives for hosting this important conversation and for allowing us to be here tonight.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Next, we have Sarah Graydon, a licensed clinical social worker with Unionville School District.
Yeah, thank you. As you said, I'm a school social worker, and I actually am based out of Unionville High School. And I am a licensed clinical social worker, which means that I'm a mental health clinician that's licensed to practice in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So as a school social worker, I provide counseling to special education and regular education students. I also provide crisis intervention, mental health consultation to staff and school teams, and I also connect families and students to various community resources. So that's a little bit about what I do. And thank you so much for having me. And I look forward to our discussion tonight.
Thank you so much. And next we have Dr. Kavita Tahalani, an adolescent psychologist from Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. Welcome, doctor.
Hi, great. Thank you so much. I am very excited to be here and have the opportunity to participate on this panel tonight. You know, I think it's been a tremendously difficult year for everyone, to say the least. And so I'm just hoping I can provide some support and resources for everyone who's watching today. So I'm Dr. Kavita Tahalani. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. I work at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. My primary role is a clinician in our anxiety behaviors clinic in the behavioral health outpatient department. So I really focus my clinical work on working with children and adolescents who present with a variety of anxiety disorders and OCD, and oftentimes other co-occurring diagnoses as well. And I typically work with the children as well as their families, and collaborate with schools and other team members in each of the child's lives. So, you know, I'm hoping to be able to share some of what I do at the clinic with all of you tonight. So thanks again.
Thank you. And next we have Dr. Kirby Wyckoff, the Director of Community and Trauma Counseling Program at Thomas Jefferson University. Welcome, Dr. Wyckoff.
Hi there, Representative Sappy. Thank you so much for having me and my colleagues here tonight to talk about this really important issue. As you noted earlier, my name is Kirby. I am a school psychologist by training and background. So all of my work clinically really involves working with kids, families, and schools. So a good fit for our conversation tonight. I've been a mental health professional for, Leah, you did the counting today. I haven't counted today, but over a decade and maybe a half, close to that. And really, my focus is on working with kids, families, and chronic traumatic stress. In my role at Thomas Jefferson University, I direct the program that trains folks to be licensed professional counselors in communities with a focus on chronic stress and trauma. So right now we're educating people to go out into the world and do really important work and address the needs of the folks in our communities, like those that we'll be talking about tonight. So I'll concur with my colleagues who have said that this has been a really difficult year for everybody. And conversations like these, where we can be candid and honest and destigmatize, are really, really important. So I'm grateful for the opportunity and glad to spend some time with you tonight.
Thank you so much. So now I'm going to turn it over to my chief of staff, Tyler Arkaton, who's going to be fielding questions from the public. And we will have our panel just jump in and tackle these questions. Feel free to, add on if you hear a question and you have another, something to build on. So take it away, Tyler.
Yes, panelists, thank you so much for joining us tonight. And I just want to remind everybody that's watching, you can still submit questions to repsappy@pahouse.net. So the first question for tonight, I think, is a great question for this age group. And that is, how do we differ between what we consider normal teen behavior with anxiety or moody behavior? And does it matter? Should we try to differ between those things?
I can try and take this one on to start us off. So I think that's a really great question. One, I think that, working in a clinical setting, I get a lot from families who are maybe seeking mental health services for the first time. They'll come in saying, I don't know, if this is rising to the level of therapy or not. So it's definitely a great question. I think teens are going through a very emotional time. It's a time of a lot of development, a lot of change. Their hormones are all over the place. And so we do expect to see a lot of shifting in mood, increased irritability. I think oftentimes it's such a switch from you know, middle school to high school, that parents are kind of alarmed at seeing this change. So I think, you know, we do expect to see some level of, you know, this type of moodiness or increased anxiety. I think, you know, when we really think about what rises to the level of therapy or seeking out, you know, clinical services, is we think about how long this has been going on. So duration. So, you know, is my child feeling irritable for like a couple hours and then is able to kind of pull themselves out of it? Or is this irritability really lasting for most of the day, for lots of days in a row? And then we also want to think about impairment. So is there shifting in mood impacting them to the point where they are not hanging out with friends anymore? They are withdrawing from family. Maybe their grades are starting to drop. So we're really looking to see the level of impairment to see, you know, is this something that could be managed at home or maybe with some outside help? But I always say it's great to consult with your pediatrician or your school counselor if you are not sure.
I'll just follow up on that and just say one of the first things I guide parents to think about is the young person in your life able to live their life the way they want to? Are they experiencing their life in the fullest way that they want to? Or are there things that are getting in the way and negatively impacting their ability to engage in school, engage with friends, engage with their family in the way they want to? If that's the case, then you know that maybe this is a time to get some support, to ask some questions, and to put things in place to help them. Because it really comes down to me for, is this getting in their way of living the life they want to? And then you can, you know, consult with folks who can help sort out the details of that. But that's one of the ways we figure out if kids need extra help or if this is just what we consider like typical sort of moodiness and irritability.
Yeah, and I'd like to add something to that too. I get that a lot from parents and students. They'll come up and they'll ask, well, isn't this normal, you know, teenage behavior? Isn't this what usually happens? And I don't think something's that bad. You know, she's still attending school. She's still working really hard and all of that. And so what I like to say is, you know, you don't need to be in crisis to seek help. We don't wait until we're bleeding from the head to see a doctor and try to get medical attention, right? We always, you know, by that time, it might be too late. We might need to go to an emergency room instead of going to your family doctor. So I'd like to say that, you know, treat emotional distress the way you would treat like physical distress, and you can seek support in that way. And then that's when it's time maybe to see a therapist, is when maybe you're just, you know, having trouble functioning and you're having trouble with daily activities and you could use a little bit extra help. And it doesn't need to be a crisis.
Thank you for that. And as a follow-up, if a parent does feel that they're starting to see that impact, how do they start to approach their child about this? And should they? Are there any tips on that?
Getting a teenager to open up to you about their feelings is not always the easiest task in the world. It's my whole job and it can be very challenging. I think it just speaks to the importance of just trying to have as much communication with your teen as you can. I think a lot of times, you know, it's pretty typical for teens to kind of pull away from parents and kind of go more towards friends. And so it's sometimes it sends this message that they don't want to talk and parents maybe stop asking questions. I think it's still really important for parents to continue to try to keep lines of communication open. And just because your teen might be acting like they're not listening to you, it doesn't mean that they aren't hearing you. And oftentimes they are taking in what you're saying. So I think as much as you can check in with them about how they're doing, kind of slowly open that door. I think that can be helpful to just sort of open the lines of communication. So if they are feeling some type of way, they'll feel like they can go to you about that.
Tyler, I'm going to jump in because I have a question. You know, my kids are in their 20s now, but I do remember when they were younger and when their peers were, you know, going through something. One of the things that we frequently heard is like, you know, you know, some mom or their mom, somebody else's parent, you know, or you mom are going to freak out if I tell you. So how do we as parents, you know, stay calm in the face of what could be scary for us? If we're, you know, if we're not really well equipped to hear what we're about to hear, how do we stay calm and just receive this information from a young person? It could be about them. It could be about their best friend or somebody they know at school that's in trouble, but they're really afraid of drama. They're like, oh God, this is going to spin out of control and I'm not going to be able to control it. What do I do? So how is the parents and adults in the community can we help with that?
Well, first, I just want to say that I think it's great that you're aware, you know, just being aware that your response, you know, will matter and everything like that. And just be aware of the way you feel about the situation is a good way to start. And then by then just, you know, opening the communication, trying to be mindful of, you know, staying calm yourself, but also sometimes a reaction is not the worst thing. Sometimes it shows that, you know, this is a big deal and this is and you're listening and you're legitimizing it and you're validating it. And then, you know, the bottom line is maybe you will have to tell somebody else, but I always say to students when I have to tell somebody else and they're scared of that becoming a big deal is that, you know, their safety is the most important thing and they're doing the right thing by telling me whatever it is that they're telling me, because we're going to make sure that everybody stays safe and, you know, we'll, that's the best way to take care of each other.
Thank you.
Can I just add on that? I think as my colleagues have pointed out, the key is to not wait until there's a thing to talk about, like a big thing with your teenager, to actually build the relationship around talking about stuff, right? If we build the building blocks in the relationship where we talk about all kinds of stuff, we talk about big stuff, we talk about little stuff, that way when a big thing comes up, you already have laid the groundwork for having open, transparent communication with your teenager so that it doesn't feel like such a big deal for them to come to you and share this information, right? Told them, we're good to talk about stuff. In this family, we can talk about things. And as an adult, I can hear you. I can have an emotional reaction, but not overreact. I can support you. I'll validate. Sarah said, validate. I love, right? Validating teenagers' feelings. Well, everybody's feelings, right? But teenagers too. If we do all that stuff before there's a crisis, then when there's a crisis, we've laid the groundwork for really good, open, candid conversation.
I'd like to jump in and just kind of add to that and maybe ask for some tips. I remember as a teenager, my dad was in recovery for most of my childhood. So he was really good at like just dealing with how to make sure he knew what was going on with us. And one of the tactics he used was he would ask us if we want to go and run our head. Like if he knew one of us were like, just like in it or feeling anxious, he would ask us, let's go for a run, like let's just run it out, whatever it is. And I remember like we would start out and we would run. The first mile would usually be pretty quiet, like I just remember those the sounds of our trotting feet, but then eventually we would just start to talk. And so I think it's a lot easier for kids when they are feeling struggling times and difficult emotions. Sometimes like sitting down and having a family meeting feels like you're being called to the principal's office, right? Like it feels like you're in trouble. But like, what are some ways that parents can build those relationships with their kids where like something like what my dad used to do, just going for a run together, and like he would not even ask any questions. He just would wait for us to start talking. And it was just, I think of that as a parent, like what a great way to like just always make sure that your kids know that there's someone to talk to.
Thanks for sharing, Danielle. That's really special.
Yeah.
That's good advice. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree. I think, you know, even in the context of a therapy session, oftentimes having a 15-year-old sitting across from me, making a lot of eye contact, trying to talk about feelings can be really overwhelming. And so even in, you know, a therapy session, we're often doing an activity together, you know, engaging the teen in something that they like to do, and not also having too much eye contact, which is, I think, something to be mindful of, especially with teens. So if you go for a walk or you go for a run and you're standing side by side versus face to face, a lot of times that can help teens feel more comfortable speaking up. Or if their hands are busy or if there's somewhere else they can look, you know, I think that can be helpful. as adults, I think when we think about communication, we think about the one-on-one sit down, and it's just, it can be too overwhelming for kids to do it that way.
I'd like to add one other thing, Dr. Talavani. You brought forward, I think, a really great topic, and that's sort of the orientation or how you're communicating. And as much as we often say that screens are a barrier for some of our students, they really do allow us to connect and communicate. So I know when we're talking with students or with any of our constituents who might be experiencing some challenges, we say, how do they want to communicate with you? And maybe it isn't this face-to-face, you know, phenomena. You can text with them, you can chat with them through any of the media that have now become sort of part and parcel of our lives. I don't think you want it to stay in those media, but it may open the doorway by using the chat or the FaceTime or whatever it may be, or some of the other social media that our teens exist in, right? The Snapchats and the TikToks and all of these things that pop up. Now, you may not be in the same accounts as your children may be, so you may have to sort of work through some of those things. But I know we've talked with many of our families who say, I'll text them from downstairs when they're up in their bedroom, and it opens the doorway for those conversations. And then eventually they do come down, and while we're eating or cleaning up or cooking dinner or whatever that activity may be, the conversations just evolve a little bit, but they started through the use of the screens. So we talk a whole lot about the negatives associated with screens, but I do just want to put the plug in there that at times they can open the doorway to some of these conversations that we want to have with our teenagers.
Dr. Ryder, you brought us right into our next question, so thank you for that. And that is, at this point, very much so teens are communicating on their own. They have their own social circles, you know, within school and social media. But what resources are specific to school are available for kids that are willing to reach out on their own?
So I'll start with that. I think there's a lot of resources that have come out. Obviously, there are things that we would encourage in person. I mean, many schools have behavioral health team members. I mean, we've got on this call Sarah, who's one of our school district school psychologists, or excuse me, school social workers, but we also have school psychologists, school counselors, nurses. We have folks that don't have all of those credentials, but are the trusted adults for our students that can open the doorway. We do also have, you know, some of the technology that has come out, like the Safe to Say tip system, if we have a student who may be in crisis and may want to reach out and do so anonymously. We also have in many school districts the opportunity for students to come to the counseling center and chat about a friend, make a referral and say, I have concerns. My peer is struggling with something and I think you might want to have a conversation with them. So I think there are some pretty basic ways to use what we have available, our computers. We have students who like to email the person that they're comfortable with. They may stop down. This year, it's been a little bit more challenging, obviously, than most to get some of that face-to-face instruction. But I know various schools have different schedules that particularly align themselves with these types of things. In our school district at our high school, we have a lunch hour in a traditional school year called Lunch and Learn. And that is really a time for our students to have the opportunity to go seek out whatever they need. It's a what I need time. If I need to eat, if I need to replenish myself with food, if I need to replenish myself by, you know, napping in the corner, if I need to reach out to a counselor, if I need to connect socially with my friends. So a lot of districts are exploring those options if they don't have them available right now to provide students with outlets where they are in control, which is one of the biggest things our teenagers report to us. They want to feel some control in their lives. And one of the ways we can do that is to allow them to schedule blocks of their time, even within the school day. So I think those are some of the things that school districts right now are exploring or implementing to help our students as they work through the challenges of just being a teenager.
And something that just came about with the pandemic is, you know, a lot of us on the behavioral health team felt like we were having some difficulty making sure that we could get resources to our students. We were used to handing them pieces of paper, you know, in our meetings and different things like that. And so we, just like a lot of other school districts across the country, developed this virtual calming room, which has different resources. It has, you know, different like sounds and music, visual relaxation, mindfulness, journaling, yoga videos, and it also has a page with that lists all the different resources in the area. So it lists like this Safe to Say. It lists the crisis text line 741-741, which is a text line which is nationwide actually, that anybody can text and you know, be connected with resources. It lists, you know, the suicide prevention hotline, but it also lists like the Valley Creek Crisis Center phone number and other local like Chester County resources. And I know Chester County also has a lot of these resources on their website. They're available all over, but, you know, we just made it this way for our school to be able to push out to our students a little bit easier. We have the link in the bottom of all of our emails, and it makes it easier too when we have some of these virtual meetings. Like when we were on virtual, I was still meeting with students to do counseling and other things, and we were able to share our screen and they were able to access it that way. So we've had to get a little creative, but you know, we've figured out certain ways.
Can I just plug my colleagues here? People like Sarah know so much about resources in the community and through the school. If you are worried about your teenager and your pediatrician is a good avenue, but your school-based mental health professional is an expert in this space. And they not only have access to school-based resources, but have connections with community providers if the need it goes beyond what the school can provide. But literally, that is what their expertise is. And do not hesitate to reach out. All of you, you know, if you live in a county, in our county, then, you know, Sarah's going to get a lot of emails after that. But people like Sarah and Leah, these are the folks that really know who to talk to in the community, who can meet your kiddos' needs. And they're there to partner with you and help you navigate what can feel like kind of an overwhelming task at times.
I have a question that I actually had a conversation last night with some friends about. Somebody made the comment, like, is it really that bad? And we were talking about like kind of like the online harassment that's happened with the, you know, the dawn of social media. And, you know, when I was younger, but certainly not young, Facebook and Twitter were the thing, right? But now there's all these other platforms. There's Facebook, there's Twitter. I was on TikTok the other day because my daughter wanted to watch something. And I was horrified at some of the things were just like organically coming up in the feed. And, I text a friend and I was like, I can't believe you let your kids do this. You know, like what was coming up in my feed was really like inappropriate. And then you've got YouTube where like there are YouTube videos with like people doing like incredibly inappropriate things. And just the intensity of the meanness, inappropriate behavior, bullying, all of the things that for our generation we were shielded from in that way. I think a lot of parents find it hard to A, believe it's as bad as it is, but B, know how to navigate it and really like set boundaries. And especially with this older age group where it's like they're doing a lot of this stuff on their own. How do we help our kids to, you know, have healthy relationships with technology and social media and all that? I can say as an adult, I struggle with it myself. And, you know, I've found like things like doing puzzles and paint by number and like things that get me away from the screens and away from the social media really help my mental state, you know, to like separate from that. And how do we help our kids with that kind of learning that balance?
I'm happy to jump in and at least kick us off. I think one of the things you said, Rep Otten, is the most critical thing is we need to model for our kids. Right? If we're attached to our screen and it's in our hands and in our pockets and at the dinner table with us, why would we expect our children to do something differently? I mean, this is, they're with us, they're with their friends all day at school. Obviously, there may be certain limitations, but right now we've put a device in every single child's hand, whether they're in kindergarten or in 12th grade. We have provided that because that's the educational model that we were forced into the pandemic. And at this time, I don't see those devices really going away in the near future. We will shift how we're using them, but it's going to be very difficult to remove that from the educational landscape. And I think it's obviously brought very positive things. So I think setting limitations, you know, kind of creating that screen diet for what is acceptable in our family and what is not acceptable, modeling it, and then setting clear boundaries and consequences, just like you would for any other thing that you have in your family. Like, these are our expectations. These are the things that we believe as a family are important. And I know those can be hard to establish. As you said, we didn't grow up with these. You know, when I was in high school, this wasn't a thing. I was lucky that I had a flip phone that I plugged into my car when I was, you know, traveling back and forth, and I just called home to say I made it safely. That's not how our students are using their technology at this point. The other big thing that is when you step back and think about it, it's not a phone. It's a computer in their pocket or a computer in their hands, and it's with them all of the time. So it's not just or at all at times for calling or texting. It's for connecting. It's for researching. It's for seeing things that maybe you would never want to see. I mean, I attended a presentation called Shape the Sky, which is a local presenter who very much dives into the different types of social media. And that's one of his major points is you wouldn't allow your child to go into a movie theater and see any kind of movie that might include pornography or violence or language. But if you hand them an iPhone at whatever age you hand that to them, you've basically opened the kingdom to that type of access to those sorts of things. So really looking at what you want for your children, having those honest and frank conversations, depending on the student's age and need, even doing things like contracts, behavioral contracts, where you may want to really establish and formalize when, how, why we will use them. And for most of us, we're providing that device. We're funding it. We're funding how it accesses our networks at home and how often it's being renewed. So as parents, sometimes we have to make the decision to remove that. Obviously, as a school-based team, if that's how we're accessing education, it's a little bit trickier, but certainly things we can monitor, what they're using their devices for, how they're accessing them, and to kind of tie to a previous question, most school districts track what students are doing on district-owned devices. So if there are concerning content or things popping up, we are being notified, we are following up, and we are notifying families as needed to what their students are using their devices for. You can get screen time reports, you can see what your kids have been doing all week. So using them and responding if there's something that needs to be responded to. And if you're not sure how to respond, that's what many of the members on this call are here for, is to provide that support and that counseling either for the family or for the student as appropriate.
And, you know, it's also, I mean, those are all really good points about setting boundaries with phone use and modeling that behavior. One of the other things to mention is not always the problem with the content, it's the access, right? So I'd had a student in my office this morning and she was talking about something and we were working on something together and she looked at her phone and she couldn't concentrate anymore. And she was really upset and had to talk about something else because somebody Snapchatted her something that was disturbing in that moment. So she had it during her counseling session with me. She couldn't help it. She was looking at the Snapchat. And also, like, you know, at the end of the day, I know when I used to go home from school, sometimes we would be able to talk on the phone and everything like that. But once, you know, phone time was up, I had to hang up the phone and I wasn't accessible until the next day, until I went to school. But students, you know, who are using their phones for their alarms and things like that are getting texts or Snapchats or things like that all hours. And so, you know, just being able to put a boundary on that and when. And it's not always necessarily, I mean, you have to set the boundaries with rules, but also this is all about relationships too, setting boundaries with relationships. Like, when is it okay not to be able to be contacted? When is it okay to turn it off or to say, you know what, I don't like getting those kinds of messages? Like, kind of having that conversation about what's acceptable in a relationship is important.
Thank you for bringing that up, because I think it's very important for our young people in high school to learn to start setting boundaries, because once they leave the home, it's going to get, you know, even more difficult, and the need for boundaries is going to really present itself. So, you know, I think it's important while we've got people at home, you know, if we can, and in schools obviously too, help with that, that's important. So thanks for bringing that up.
Representative Sappy, to build on what you just said, I think one of the keys in navigating the social media space is actually doing what you just said, which is teaching kids how to navigate, teaching them how to be safe in the social media sort of space, teaching them how to know when they should or shouldn't be contacted, about what they should or should not be contacted, literally giving them life skills so they can go out and manage that for themselves when they do leave us is really important. The other thing that's really important is what we started with. I think Representative Otten, you had said you were looking at maybe TikTok, right? And you saw something, you were like, whoa, I was not expecting that. Get familiar with the apps that your young people are on, right? Get to know how they work, what is up there, what your kids are doing on there. The more familiar you are with that technology, the better able you will be to communicate with your teens about it and feel like you're empowered to have conversations around this important issue. We'll also say that a lot of the research is telling us that social media, especially things like likes and, you know, the validation that comes from that, actually light up sort of the addiction parts of the brain. And we really have to be aware of sort of the science behind the use of technology and how we can, again, teach our kids about that and then help them navigate it and stay safe when they use it.
Okay, thank you, everybody. And I do want to remind our guests watching in that you can still submit questions to RepSappy at pahouse.net. And we did have one question come in about resources, and we can certainly share a follow-up email with resources for parents and families. So we will be happy to do that after this event. A specific question that came in tonight is, my child is 17 years old and I want to encourage them to make their own decisions, but I feel they are taking unnecessary risks during the pandemic. How can I confront them with this and encourage less risky behavior?
Yeah, I think for this one, it really comes back to what we were speaking about before in terms of communication and really sort of having that foundation with your teen that you can be open about concerns that you have about decisions that they're making. You know, we do want to empower our teens, especially 16, 17, 18, to be thoughtful about their decisions and try and take some ownership and have some independence. At the same time, if we're talking about risk or safety concerns related to themselves or potentially putting others at risk, you know, it is important, you know, as the parent to still set those boundaries and limits around that. So it's autonomy and independence to a point as they, you know, kind of learn about, you know, how to make these decisions. But I know there's been, you know, a lot of tension at times between teens and parents around social events during the pandemic and wanting to see friends, seeing friends on social media, going out or going to parties and maybe not being as mindful of the precautions and the social distancing rules. So really being able to sit down with your teen and talk it through with them, validate their feelings. I think that's one of the most important things. I know that came up before too, that you can do with the teen. I think they just want to feel heard and know that, you know, we are taking their wants and their needs seriously. So I think we can validate their concerns, their feelings, talk to them about their perspective and maybe try and reach a middle ground, you know, maybe not that party that everyone's going to, but maybe an outdoor, you know, safe outing with one friend or two friends where they can be masked and apart. So really trying to find compromise, but ultimately, you know, as the parent saying, this is unsafe and this is not a good idea.
That's a really good question, Tyler. Thanks for sharing that with us and for the parent who asked it. I've seen that so much with young people over the course of the last year. I'm sure Danielle, you have too, because you're very connected in your community as well. But it really hurts. It really, really hurts when they see their friends getting together, and you know, you might be the family that says this isn't safe, and other families are saying it's okay. It puts the kids in such a tough situation, and it's painful. It really hurts them. So thank you for sharing that, Doctor.
Yeah, and to add to that too, there's also we've experienced it in our family where other families have different opinions and those things are coming to your household. So as a parent, having to have those conversations with like neighbors and friends, and it's even something I think parents are struggling with, not just the kids too. Like, how do you have that conversation with your neighbor? How do you not just explain to your kids that like you have a different perspective on it, but to the other families in your community? I think a lot, I've heard, Chris, you're right, like I've heard it a lot. I've seen a lot, even with my own kids and they're little. It's a real struggle because it's not just the kids, but it's also the family and neighbors and relationships between parents as well, I think.
Sarah, did you want to add?
Well, yeah, I was going to say, I mean, this is the problem that's, you know, compounded by the pandemic, right? I mean, teenagers are always, you know, they're more likely to try risky behaviors because, you know, their brain isn't completely fully developed. So we have that working against them. And, you know, they're more interested in immediate things and to try out risky things. That's actually part of what they're developmentally supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be taking some risks. But, you know, the other thing that their brain and their stage of development is trying to get them to do is to constantly be with their peers, to separate from their families, to interact with their peers. So you have both of those things, right? They feel like they can more likely take those risks, but they also really want to be with their peers. And so, you know, add those together. So it just makes sense that that's what they would want to do. And also, you know, 17, 18 year olds, they tend to look more grown up and they're not, you know, their brain isn't fully developed yet. So we have to remember that. And, you know, I think it's important to hopefully be able to have those conversations. Like we were saying before, if you've developed a relationship or started to have the conversation about what safety is to your family and really being able to break down some pros and cons and just be kind of concrete about it and try to keep kind of some of that emotion out of it and say, these are the pros and these are the cons of these behaviors and, you know, go from there. And as for other families doing other things, that is really difficult right now. I mean, we have situations with school where, you know, our high school's back full day in person every day. And we still have some families with maybe some immunocompromised children in the home or other situations where they don't feel safe sending their their kids to school yet. And so, you know, these students are at home and they're not able to be with their friends even in school. And that's based on their family. And so, you know, it's a reality and it's really hard. But again, it's just kind of, you know, your relationship with your child, starting the conversation about it and just having that honest conversation about what's important and what's safe and you setting the boundaries and helping the student, you know, your child see that and respect those boundaries.
And I do want to acknowledge that this situation has always existed. So, you know, you want to go to the party, and your mom finds out that there's going to be a keg and drugs or who know, or parents aren't going to be home. You know, these things have always happened and we've always been told, no, you can't. And, you know, we had to deal with that. So the consequences, I think, of what we're going through in the pandemic, though, can spiral out of control so quickly and can impact so many people that it's kind of a unique situation. But I did want to acknowledge for some folks who are listening that, you know, these things have always existed and we've always had to respond as parents and community members to, you know, you have to say no sometimes, but this one is a tough one. This has been unique. So thank you.
So opposite side of the same coin here, we have a parent who is concerned. Their child has always been introverted, but the pandemic has made them even more so. How can they encourage socialization and should they be concerned about that?
I just this morning had a conversation with a parent who asked that very same question, and I'll share a little bit about what we discussed and then I think some of my colleagues who are experts in anxiety disorders might also have something to say about this. But one of the things that we talked about was how the challenges that have maybe always existed for a young person are now amplified, right? We've sort of in this very unique, unusual situation where the things that were there now seem maybe worse or more challenging than they did before. So the first was just acknowledging that, right? And talking about how that is a reality for this family. The next thing that we talked about was really partnering with, in this case, it was an adolescent girl, teenager, around how would it look for her to connect with peers, right? So what would being in contact or relationship with peers look like in the pandemic for her? So while it might look different than it did before, or they might be withdrawing more than they did before, really partnering around identifying what could it look like for you to connect with peers and build relationships given what's going on right now, right? And then certainly using some really good cognitive behavioral techniques around anxiety management and sort of working through where that's coming from would be really, really useful. And again, that's where I know my colleagues are gonna have some ideas about that. But I see this as an opportunity to partner with your peer, with your child and really have a conversation around what this means for them, what your goals are for them, hearing what their goals are for themselves, and identifying a plan together on how best to move forward. And for some, that may involve treatment for anxiety.
Yeah,
Yeah, exactly. I was just thinking about a kiddo of mine as you were speaking, who came in to see me with a diagnosis of social anxiety. But now that she's been virtual and dance classes canceled and sports are canceled, she's has no anxiety. She's, you know, reporting that she's doing great. Meanwhile, parents are super concerned about, you know, the consequences going forward for all of this. So I think treating social anxiety right now is quite difficult because, you know, how we would traditionally treat that, you know, in addition to helping a child or a teen develop appropriate coping skills and supports and things like that, we would really want them to engage in what we would call, you know, exposure exercises. So basically experiments we design to face the thing that's making you feel anxious. So with social anxiety, we would come up with all different kinds of experiments to try. Ordering at a restaurant, you know, talking to someone in a store, asking for a different size and an article of clothing, raising your hand in class, and sort of practicing these kinds of interactions. With everything the way it is right now, it's really difficult to kind of design those types of things. So I think, you know, trying to be creative in terms of ways to promote some interaction, whether it be, you know, virtual hangouts with friends, even small things like if it's safe going to, you know, on a trip to the grocery store or maybe participating more in class. So really trying to find some avenues where they can practice being social. I think, you know, as we all come out the other side of this, we're all going to be a little rusty in our social skills and we're all going to need to kind of practice some of this. But just finding ways to help your teen still try and put themselves out there, you know, could be helpful. And I will say, you know, and I'm not sure the specifics of the question that came in, but, you know, sometimes, you know, you have an introverted child and you have a socially anxious child and they're not necessarily the same. So sometimes introverts, you know, are comfortable in social situations, but they actually just need that alone time to recharge. They prefer having alone time. So being an introvert isn't necessarily something we would need to treat. What we would want to treat is any distress that a teen might be experiencing in the social situations that they're in. So just want to make that distinction as well. An introverted child isn't necessarily a socially anxious child.
That's that same part that we talked about earlier around how much does it interfere with them wanting and being able to live their life? Like introverts are not distressed by needing to spend time alone to recharge, right? So that key around, does this get in their way of living the life that they want to and the ways that they want to? Same key question comes up here.
I just wanted to quickly highlight all of that is incredibly true, but the tie to schools, because obviously that's sort of one of the biggest things that's been changing. And for a socially anxious child where now schools are opening and for many schools, there's an option, right? I can still learn from home or I could possibly go in person. And we've had students who were avoiding school pre-pandemic, but for our students who are socially anxious, this has been a challenge for them because they've been able, without really any consequence, to be in that home environment and potentially, as you shared with the individual you are working with, reduce a lot of the anxiety because those experiences just don't exist. And so now we have to relearn all of those skills. And so I know the school avoidance piece has been a big topic of conversation for our high school teams. You know, students are with, in terms of attendance, are they coming in? Are they participating? Are cameras on if they are participating remotely? Are they engaging? Are they submitting work? So again, leaning on the school teams, if it's something that the social anxious child, maybe they are coming into school, but more often than not, we're seeing that they're completely avoiding school in whatever fashion that looks like. And so as that starts to snowball, in effect, it just is sort of that snowball, right? It's bigger and then I get more anxious and then I don't want to go back to school because now I'm missing assignments and I haven't seen my friends and I don't know how to ask for help from my teachers. So we don't have a perfect solution, but we do have supports in place and we definitely have people who can start to work us through those processes and we have them in place. If it's something that's newer developing because of the challenges faced by the pandemic for the student that may have some social anxiety, you know, having an MTSS, which is a multi-tiered system of support approach, where we have sort of that tier one, or which is where all students are getting things, or that tier two, where we might see more of that impairment or that impact. So most school districts have a group of trained, ready, and willing individuals who want to partner with families and with students to help them work through these processes. So my suggestion would be, if we have a family who has a child who might have some social anxiety, in addition to the community-based supports, is connect with your school counselor or connect with a principal or assistant principal in your child's building and let them know. And we will certainly be there to help them and give some guidance to the parents and to the child as they work through this. And there is a requirement from the state to sort of have these teams in place. So it would be highly unlikely that any school district in Chester County, for sure, would not have one, if not more than one, team ready, willing, and able to support your child.
Yeah, I was thinking that up. Go ahead.
Sorry, I was just going to add that, you know, onto that, as you can hear, as anybody who's listening right now and watching can hear, if your child is one of those, is having difficulty maybe getting back into the school atmosphere and all of that, that they're, you guys aren't alone, that we work with these students all the time. Every school has some system and some way to work to support you and your child and pace in a way that everyone's comfortable to get back into to school and back into that type of schedule.
That's something.
I just add one little piece to go back to tie sort of some things together. That exposure idea that Dr. Tahilani mentioned earlier is something that many school districts have, and we commonly call it in our district sort of a return to learn plan or program. So really working with a family and with the student at their pace. So it doesn't have to be that because of, you know, the social anxiety that I may be feeling as a student, that I have to go from being home all day every day to now being in person all day every day. We can certainly work with a family or with a student to plan that. Maybe I just come in and I sit in my homeroom or my advisory, or maybe I come in for the class that I have maybe a friend in, or I'm connected to the teacher, or I like the content the most. And then we slowly expand that out over time and with the right supports in place. And then, you know, we scaffold up or down based on how the child is doing in those environments. So it's not an all or nothing. And, you know, there may be steps forward and steps backward, but that's what, you know, we have these great trained folks like the folks on this call to help us navigate through those waters. And, you know, we will connect if there are outside supports to in-school supports to make sure that what's happening in the community can be supported in the school, and what's happening in the school can also be supported in the community.
And can I just ask a quick wrap up of that conversation? And that is that as I listen to this, I'm hearing my own experience with my own son in the scaffolding up and scaffolding down conversations we've been having it for months with school. And what I do know is that it's incredibly stressful for parents. Like, it's parents right now are working. They're in many cases, like, they're working at home. So it's like all blending together. And then the kids are struggling. And so they need more support from their parents. And so I don't know if anyone, I mean, I know you guys specialize in kids, but I'm sure you deal with a lot of stressed out parents too. How do parents cope and take care of themselves as their demands on them are just so intense right now? You know, I just feel for, like, I'm hearing this conversation, I'm thinking, like, I know that our family's been going through it. I know that friends have been going through it, regardless of what age their child is. And so, especially for those of us who are working full time and just managing it all, and all in one space, like at home, it just kind of feels like a tornado has blown through our lives for a full year. And how do parents, like, support themselves through that to be able to give their kids what they need?
I love this question, Representative Otten. I so appreciate your candor in acknowledging that this is really, really hard, right? And it's not just really hard for kids and adolescents, but it's really hard for everyone. And while all of us on this call focus our work clinically and otherwise on young people, we all know that young people come attached to older folks, right? That families are a system, and that you can't actually work with that young person without also acknowledging that that young person is embedded in a complex system of other people that also need to be a part of the conversation. So I know in my work, and I'm certain for my colleagues as well, that there is never a time that I'm not collaborating to help a kid that doesn't involve partnering with parents, because parents are actually part of our treatment team, right? So if you've got a school-based social worker, maybe you've got a licensed clinical psychologist, you as a parent are a part of that team, and your voice and your needs are incredibly important in that conversation. that then leads to conversations that I have sometimes with parents around, what do you need, parent, to show up in the ways that you want to, right? You cannot give what you do not have. And we have a lot of conversations around self-care, around things that parents need in order to best support their kids. So often you'll hear parents say, well, my kids' needs are more important than mine. And I challenge parents on that, because the reality is, unless we take care of ourselves and show up for ourselves in the way we need to, we're not ever going to be able to show up for our kids in the way that we need and want to.
And it's also, to piggyback off that, it's modeling great behavior, taking care of yourself. Your kid sees you taking care of yourself. They know that they need to take care of them. You know, that they should also prioritize themselves. And sometimes it can be as simple, I mean, just, this isn't even me clinically. I mean, personally, you know, the way I was dealing with it, working from home and working I have two children also and helping them, you know, is we would go on hikes, we'd go on walks together, and it would be good for all of us for self-care, right? We'd all be getting that physical activity. And I think I just heard recently on some, from somewhere that, you know, they were saying something about the cure for stress can't be self-care. It has to be all of us caring for each other. And that's something that, you know, as parents, we can model for our kids even while we're not feeling our best.
And I just thank you so much for everyone for these comments on this one question. This was a great one, Danielle. So the one thing I can tell you from the state level is that, you know, we have identified this issue. We understand it's big. It's I think everyone's recognizing it. So, you know, and the level of teams Dr. Ryder mentioning, you know, in schools does vary by, you know, dependent on school funding, which is unfortunate. But there is money coming through the American Recovery Act for schools. There's, you know, this is a historic level of investment in a lot of different avenues, but education, K through 12 education, is going to be receiving a tremendous amount of funding, and there will be funding there for mental health. But I know we were talking to our superintendents, and I know Danielle is too, that are saying, you know, we're getting ready for what we're going to see. We're just scratching the surface now as we do start to return into the building with our adolescent folks, and what is that going to look like? And they know that it's going to be coming to the surface in a variety of different ways. And so our schools are really challenged right now trying to figure out how to address something when they really don't know how it's going to look and the magnitude of it and how many people will be impacted. So I think, you know, we've got great systems in place now, and hopefully we'll be able to build on that going forward.
So a great question that I want to get to here is, this age group is filled with so many milestones, whether it's graduation, homecoming, prom, all of those things. How do we help teens overcome the disappointment of those big moments not coming into place like they thought they would?
This is a tough question, as you can see, none of us clamoring to jump on it, because the reality is hard. This is really, really tough. I just had a conversation with a graduate student around the fact that their graduation is not happening in the way that they wanted to. For me, the thing that I've been doing and the way that's been helping me navigate these conversations is to acknowledge it and give ourselves permission to grieve, right? We are grieving the loss of something that we thought was going to happen, a thing that we thought was going to be a big, important part of this chapter of our life. And it's okay to acknowledge that we feel sad that that's not gonna happen in the ways that we thought it was going to. In addition to that, I also have a lot of conversations around what are ways that we could celebrate and acknowledge milestones given the constraints that we're in right now, right? COVID shouldn't mean that we don't acknowledge them and celebrate them. It does mean that they're going to look different, and that'll probably come with some feelings of sadness, grief, loss, anger. But what can we do to celebrate and acknowledge so that we find a way to live our lives even while COVID's happening? So for me, it's that those two parts, right? Acknowledging the feelings that we have around it, knowing it's okay to grieve, and also trying to identify alternative ways, creative ways, maybe different ways that we might come together and celebrate some of those important things.
Yeah, I'm really pleased that you use the word grief, and you're sort of describing it in this way of grief and loss, because that's really what it is. And I think it's important for adults and parents and caregivers to really kind of see that, okay, you know, it's prom, you know, to someone who's been out of high school for 30, 40 years, maybe it doesn't feel like that big of a deal. But to a 17-year-old who is going to, you know, go with their friends and have that experience, that iconic experience, it's a huge loss. And so I think really appreciating the gravity of this and how meaningful and impactful these losses are is going to be really important. I think we don't want to minimize it or brush it aside or tell them to, you know, just look ahead to the next thing. I think it is important to take the time to honor the loss and the grief that they're experiencing. And then, yes, you know, find alternative ways so that it's not this all or nothing sort of thing. But I think taking the time to acknowledge the loss is really important.
I think it's also really important as the adults in that equation to recognize it's a loss for us, as well as the parents who don't get to see the graduation or take the prom photos and, you know, watch their child we've been planning, you know, as parents sometimes 17, 18 years to get to this point. And now this point just isn't the same as it was initially in our thoughts and dreams. But that doesn't mean that we still, as, you know, Dr. Wyckoff said, we can still celebrate. It may look different, but we can still honor the milestone and the accomplishment and the activity. It may just be something different and, you know, look for the silver linings where we can, but certainly acknowledge the loss both for our students that are going through it, but also for ourselves as the parents and the adults in some of these situations, because it's a loss for us too.
And I'd like to add too that it's, you know, what I've been amazed about through all of this working with high school kids is how resilient they've been. You know, how resilient they, I mean, yes, they've grief and loss. We acknowledge it. We don't want to just paint a rosy picture, but, you know, I've seen them lose so much and still have so much resilience and be able to have perspective and, you know, build on that. And I think that's something important to recognize too, is how resilient all of us are, but especially, honestly, our kids. Our kids are showing some amazing resilience right now.
Just to take that a little step further, I think involving the student in the conversation for the celebration, I know for our district in particular, so we can't have the graduation that we've had for years past at this indoor event arena where we have, you know, as much family as you want and it's in person. But what can we do and how can we make this special for you? So I know we've made a very concerted effort to not only involve our parents, obviously, in the conversation, but to involve our seniors or our juniors, you know, what could the prom look like? What can we do? You know, how can we honor our students? I know just this week, our high school administrative team drove around with their congratulations class of 2021 signs, and they're now all over the yards in our neighborhood. And we're talking about, you know, an outdoor type prom and what will that look like and sort of some of those things. So it will be different, but it still can be a milestone event. And so I think, as Sarah said, that resiliency and, you know, I think some of the things we're doing will be things that will become the new traditions and how we can look back in 5 or 10 years and say, wow, this was really hard and really challenging, but now look how it's changed our trajectory for our high school programming moving forward. So I think that's a really great thing for us to remember as well.
So the next question has to do with the next steps after those milestones. And that is, you know, it's unclear what next fall might look like. And for our graduating seniors, what is already an unknown of college or whatever the next steps may be, has an even heightened anxiety around it because it's unclear to almost everybody exactly what things will look like. Are there any considerations or tips for helping our graduating seniors looking ahead and going into that environment? I know I gave you two very difficult questions here at the end. I understand that.
Can I just kind of add on to that question a little bit? One of the things I actually do some work with my international sorority, and so I still work with a lot of young adults. And I find myself telling this story over and over again, that my only regret in this life, like, I've done lots of things that, like, wish I had done differently and, you know, I had to learn from. But, like, my only regret in life is that when I was young, I was in such a rush to get a job, buy a house, do all the things, get married, have a car payment, all of those things. And what I realize as an adult is that like, we have so much time for all of that. And like, I wish I had backpacked across Europe at some point when I was in college, or like just done some of the things that like other people have experienced because they've taken that time and not rushed into adulthood. And so, you know, while I think that so many of our kids, you know, have this expectation of like college is next and this is what I'm going to do and this is how it goes, sometimes this, you know, fork in the road could bring really cool opportunities and gifts to your life. And like, what are the possibilities of things that you could do if college, if maybe next year we're not, like last year I had an intern who was saying like college is just really not working out right now because of all this. And I was like, your parents are probably going to kill me for saying this to you, but like, it's okay to take a year off. It's okay to take a year off, save that money and go do something fun. Like backpack the Appalachian Trail or do something that, that will like feed you instead of completely creating all the stress in your life. You're so young, you have so much ahead of you and so much time for all of this. Like maybe there are some alternatives for some kids if like next year might not be the year to like start college right away.
I totally agree with that, Danielle. I think I've seen over the course of like when our kids were starting to look at colleges to now, the concept of taking a gap year after high school has really changed. Back then it was like, are you kidding? If I don't go to college, I'll never go. And you know, this is, you're going to fall off a cliff and never have any friends. And it's just going to be the end of the world. And I think people are looking at it very differently. And I think the pandemic has really enhanced the way we look at what happens after college. And when you think about it, yeah, I think the largest number of full-time students in the PASHE system are people that are non-traditional students at this point. So we've got a lot of people going off and doing other things and working to make some money and then going back to school. So I think we're looking at that. You know, we've looked at the high school and the whole higher education thing in a very linear way over the years. And that was in the process of changing, and the pandemic has just really brought that up. So I couldn't agree more in being more flexible in terms of what comes next, because this entire generation is going to be doing things very differently. And when you do things differently, it really, really fosters innovation and creativity. So I'm looking forward to seeing what happens. I think it's going to be really cool because they're going to do it differently than we did it.
I'll just add on that. I think in order to be creative and innovative, like Representative Sappy, you just talked about, that means in some ways, letting go of some of our rigid expectations that we have for what things look like after high school, right? So traditionally it may be, right, you think college is the next step. Maybe it's not, and that's okay, right? Sort of acknowledging that sometimes for the grownups in a kid's life, we're the ones that are more attached to the idea of college or a certain type of college than our young people are. And really, I think partnering with them and engaging with them in conversation around, what do you want next for you? What feels like the best next step for you? Certainly as a parent, you're still gonna be the guide and the coach and the mentor, but as grownups, us acknowledging what we're attached to and the ideas that are really about us and not about our young person, I think is really, really important. Once we acknowledge that, then we can free ourselves up to be innovative and creative and think about, well, what could this look like? What might be the best next step for you, right? And whether that is college or that's something else, I would encourage young people to build relationships when you get there, right? The relationships you have, the people you have around you, the supports in place, whether again, that's in college, whether you go to community college up the street or you go out of state or you don't go at all, but thinking ahead to how do I get support when I need it, when I'm there? Who do I go to? How do I build relationships? Those relationships are gonna be what helps sustain you and helps you navigate the uncertainty of what's coming next.
And I think we're all starting to touch on this. You all have a little bit, but my last question is, what positive takeaways do you see from the pandemic for our teens?
I mean, I started to talk a little bit about the resilience factor, right? You know, if we're not tested, how do we know how resilient we can be? You know, we've come out of a lot of this. Some of us have come out with a lot of resilience, and people have struggled a lot, but you know, have realized what types of strengths they have within themselves to get them through hard times. I think another thing that has come out of this is the normalization and the destigmatizing a little bit more about mental health. People are talking about mental health more. People are asking for help. Therapists have, I don't know whether, you know, therapists have long wait lists and are full because, you know, everybody's actually feeling more feelings and need it, or whether they just finally feel like, okay, it's fine to seek the help that I need. And the fact that we're talking about this right now shows that. So those are a couple of things I think that we're getting from it.
Yeah, I'll just add that one thing I've noticed with the teenagers that I've been working with is, you know, the increased time has given them the opportunity to educate themselves on things that they are interested in and passionate about. They've gotten involved in, you know, things going on in their community, causes that they're passionate about, and they've really sort of risen to the occasion to inform themselves and to put themselves out there in a way that, you know, I hadn't seen as much of before. And so I think that's been really wonderful to see that out of all of this loss and grief and uncertainty, they've been able to cultivate new passions and interests. And I think that's been one positive.
As a sort of a follow-up, I'm going to take a little bit of a turn, but as a follow-up to that question about what are the positives that we can take out of this and you know, what do we learn from this situation? I think it's also important to think about that it's okay to not be okay. And this idea of seeing the positives and just the positives and focus on, you know, everything's gonna be fine, this too shall pass. You hear all sorts of sort of language around that. It's okay to also not be okay, right? It's okay to recognize that things are really hard right now. And while, yes, we wanna focus on positive emotions and the positive aspects of this, doing so exclusively and not also acknowledging that this is really hard and it's okay to not be okay is really important. So I would just encourage us to sort of look at all angles of this and make sure that we're giving space for all the feelings about this to be felt, even the ones that are not so positive or aren't so focused on what we gain from a adversity like this.
I think just to sort of take it in one other direction, since, you know, we're here sort of as a school-based team, at least some of us, is the changes in education and the flexibility that our students, I think it's tied to the resiliency, but our students have been uber flexible this year. I mean, on any given day, not necessarily knowing what your educational environment's going to look like. So I think we have prepared them for the challenges that could be ahead and to even tie it to college and career. I mean, we don't know what careers could look like in 5 or 10 years, but this has given us an opportunity. A year ago, we never would have said that we could have completely changed our educational system to go from being in a brick and mortar classroom to being in home environments. And our kids weathered that, our parents have weathered that. And I think, you know, we're in a really great place to take what we've learned over these past 15 months and push it even further. So I'm excited to see what our students who have experienced this will then do for us in the future, and what, you know, crazy new exciting careers and opportunities and things they will create for us as they sort of enter that adult world. So it's definitely been a challenge, but I think the opportunities are endless as we move forward.
Well, thank you all so much for joining us tonight. You're all so gifted, and what you have to share with our communities has been very, very important and very reassuring, and you know, gives us that strength to keep going forward. So thank you again. I just want to remind folks who are watching, the fourth and final in this series of youth and mental health during the pandemic will be Wednesday, May 19th, where we will be talking about young adults. So the challenges that those folks in that age group are facing during the pandemic and going forward. And that's, you know, going to be another really great conversation we're looking forward to with Rep. Otten. And I'm going to turn it over to my friend to close us out here. Thank you so much again.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you to everybody for joining us again tonight. This has been a great conversation. And I said it on the last one, and I'll say it again today. I just think that The future is so bright, and our kids are having gone through this are going to come out so much stronger, whether they're 15, 20, 25, 43, we're all going to be stronger because of this year, even though it feels so challenging right now. And so I think that's the biggest positive out of all of this. And I'm so grateful that we're having conversations like this, because 2 years ago, we were kind of just trying to figure out, like, how do we fix these issues that our kids are facing? And here we are having this robust conversation. And so just want to say thanks again, and keep doing the good work, because this is really important work. Thank you.
Thank you all. Have a good night.